Good evening again. This is Ramon from Bold Like a Leopard, BOLD in capital on Facebook and struttingleopard.blogspot.com. And today, this is a video I'm doing separate from my current series on the Obama wrap-up of his 8 years of being president. It's still a political topic. And we're going to talk about a few issues today that have to do with, first of all, the Trump transition. Then there's the continued cultural backlash against him, as seen on Sunday during the Golden Globes ceremony with Meryl Streep. We're going to talk about Hillary Clinton and Michelle Obama, all of these rumors about her running for public office. We might actually sneak in a couple words about these books I've been reading for my personal, hobby, which I call the Bill and Hillary Clinton Presidential Penitentiary Library. And it's not really a thing. It's just, I have a bookshelf. And it's just getting filled with books about the Clintons and maybe a couple other people. The Clintons, they could probably start a new Alexandria library just on dirt books about them, because they just keep doing things that they break all convention. I mean, I don't understand why people are so up in arms about Donald Trump. I mean, the real person who started that whole disrespect for the office of the president, I don't think it was Donald Trump, it was Bill Clinton, and I'll talk about that later. But first things first, let's talk about confirmations and about the politics in our new Congress. As you know, the GOP did keep control of both the House and the Senate. The Senate, they have a smaller majority of 52-48. If you count Bernie Sanders as a Democrat, which he should be counted as a Democrat, this whole bullshit where he goes back to the Senate as an independent is one of the biggest farces that I've seen in years. He ran for office as a Democrat for president, and that's what he should be called from now on. And this whole charade that he's doing, that he's an independent, I think is meaningless. He actually has a leadership position in the Democratic caucus. So he's not an independent. There's nobody to convince anymore, Bernie, about you being an independent. There's either people who are just Bernie freaks, and they will consume any pile of manure that he shoves their way, or there's people who they've gotten used to him and they just accept it. But they should really call him out. You've run for president as a Democrat, you registered as a Democrat in order to run for president. You stop hiding behind this false independent label. You're just as much of a Democrat as the other senator in your state, just as much of a Democrat as Chuck Schumer. And the other issue is, and that's kind of related to Sanders, is that the GOP, I believe, is gonna. That's kind of why a lot of people did support Trump, because of the GOP. And I've had arguments with people where they say, well, you support so many conservative positions. How can you support such a guy like, they want me to explain things that Mitch McConnell does. And they're like, well, how can you explain all the money that he wastes on everything? Hey, newsflash, I've hated Mitch McConnell for years. The chinless bastard. And I've seen the GOP for decades just be a complete disgrace to all the principles that they claim to represent, just as much as the Democrats are. It's just the same old song and dance. It's just a different dancer. I kind of think of it like the Canada geese metaphor. You have these birds, they just, the geese, obviously, And when it's warm, they fly home to Canada. They spend the summer there, and then when it gets cold, they fly down to south, and they pass through here in Ohio on their way south. And the whole metaphor is that when it's their turn in the opposition, they give the cold shoulder. You know, they fly away. They claim, oh, we're not gonna be for spending money on frivolous things, which is that's what the Republicans always claim when they're in the opposition, which they were under Obama. Well, in reality, as I actually found out, I was listening to Levin, Mark Levin, who I'm not a huge fan of his show, but sometimes I like his rage outs. It's sort of a style that I can identify with. The Senate GOP, I mean, allowed President Obama to sign a treaty with Iran, the Iran nuclear deal, that delivered money to Iran unnecessarily. There was no need to give them anything. If anything, they should have demanded that Iran drop all grievances against the United States. And there's no reason to bribe a state to give up nuclear weapons. It's probably one of the most ridiculous, one of the most ridiculous negotiation points I've ever heard. You don't bribe people to give up their weapons, which they're not gonna do. And we're discovering now that there's more uranium going to Iran. And that's not the topic for today. We're not gonna talk about foreign policy today. The foreign policy issues, I think I'm gonna save for a two-part special that's part of the wrap-up. And there it's probably gonna be towards the end, because there's more news coming about foreign policy related to Obama, probably in about 5 days in Paris. There's a big Middle East quote-unquote peace conference. Who knows what other allies he's gonna piss off until then. So we're talking about the Senate confirmations. There's all this noise now about Jeff Sessions, this senator from Alabama who's been nominated for attorney general. So far as I can see, he's been serving alongside this group of clowns for decades. The Senate is just full of these career acrobats. All they do is they fly through the air with their rhetoric, and then when it comes time to really give the or deliver their promises, suddenly they just disappear. It's a magic act. It's that's the circus of the Senate. You know, you have these people flying in the air, delivering all this flowery language, and then when it's time to pay the piper, you see them vote for things that are that just like this Bob Corker guy from Tennessee. They vote for things that are contrary to what they believe. I think that might happen with Jeff Sessions. I think they might cave. And this is a person who was serving with them for a while in the Senate. I don't have his info up. But to think that they wouldn't nominate somebody who's been serving alongside them for years, and they've had to cooperate with him on committee, and they don't have any evidence of anything he did while he was in the Senate being racist as they've claimed him to be. I really wonder if the GOP can stick to its principles on that. And then there's another confirmation hearing that I think is legitimately going to have problems. I said when he nominated Rex Tillerson, when Trump nominated Rex Tillerson, the CEO from ExxonMobil, as the new Secretary of State, I said, this for me, this is the first case where I'm just going to say I'm against what Trump says. And I don't care how many people say, oh, he delivered the popular will when he became president. The popular will is not bought and sold by big oil. Okay, we're not the if Trump came into office to continue this trend of big oil being a determining lobbying factor in our foreign policy, and now becoming a deciding factor, the guy who cuts the cord on various decisions, the guy who pushes the buttons, which would be Rex Tillerson. I'm gonna say I have to oppose that President-elect Trump, and I'm not gonna support Rex Tillerson as the new Secretary of State. He's been heaped on us for this is a stranger basically. We have nothing to go with his record. Look, if you want to nominate somebody who has foreign policy experience and business experience, there's plenty of examples in the business world. There's, you could go through most industries, the steel industry. You could probably find a few people. And there's no names that come to my head right now, but a person who comes from the oil industry. And everybody's talking about his ties with Russia. Yeah, that is also a real concern. But to me, the real problem is that United States foreign policy has for the better part of the 20th century and into our century been governed by big oil interests, by the petroleum industry. And that hasn't helped us. It's gotten us into wars. It's gotten us into conflicts in the Gulf, the Persian Gulf. There was the Persian Gulf War. Okay, that you could say that was a justified war, but it led to more. There was the Iraq War. There was our selling of arms to Iran during the Iran-Iraq War. There were all of our pacts with countries that, I mean, we still do business with countries that deliver us oil because it's the lifeblood of our economy, but it doesn't have to necessarily be this way. The alternative fuels that people are developing, that's the way to go. And it's not gonna get encouraged by a Secretary of State that's beholden to big oil interests. And if, you know, Russia is an oil state, we don't talk about why Rex Tillerson was a friend of Russia. Russia has a massive oil industry, petroleum refining industry, and obviously reserves that they mine. And it's no different. And there's other countries throughout the world that they are, I forgot what the word is, but they're petroleum states. I think it was like patriarchy or something, but patriarchy I think is a word that means something else. So these are our petro states. I think that's what it was. And we have to move away from treating our foreign policy that way. And I think that if Rex Tillerson is confirmed, this whole idea of draining the swamp to me is going to have to be something that'll be demanded in opposition to Trump's foreign policy, at least. Hopefully, he'll prove me wrong. You know, I can't. Look, when Obama came into office, I did withhold judgment for a while until I saw that he was leading us down the path to an overhaul of the healthcare industry that was not going to help anybody. Okay, that was the determining factor. I didn't vote for him, and I didn't vote for his opponent. So in this case, I did vote for Donald Trump, but the factor that led me to do it was, you know, it's just a hatred I've had for years for Hillary Clinton. I've just known the bitch too long. I've known everything that she's done. I mean, you could say, oh, you don't know him personally, but this pattern of behavior that she did, that caused me to vote for Trump. This is Donald Trump also, he has many problematic aspects to his relationship. We're going to get to that in a second, or at least the discussion of that. But the Rex Tillerson nomination, I'm going to say right now, I wrote a piece where I opposed it, and I'm still going to oppose it until I see any definite proof that we're not being guided by oil interests, by the desire to just get after that black gold. That's not why I voted for a president. You know, I could have stayed home. It's just more the same, and it has nothing to do with being, you know, for the environment or for being against the war. I just think that we need a Secretary of State that is not an oil pawn. Okay, that's the way I think, and you know, the these other Secretary of States that have been here recently. Hillary Clinton is for sure an oil pawn. She takes money from big oil all the time. John Kerry also, when he ran for president, I believe he took money from big oil. I don't think he's as big of a, as egregious of a pawn as Hillary Clinton was, as big of a pawn as Bush's entire administration was. But it's wrong, and it's wrong for both sides. And that's why I believe, and I'm saying this now, this is an idea. If anybody's out there watching, we should kind of start this snowball rolling. Is that we have one person in the Senate who really is not buckling to this nonsense GOP mainstreaming of you know, just their corporate interests, and that's Senator Paul from Kentucky. Ironically, he's from the same state as Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, and they're usually at odds. I'm going to say this. We should lobby Senator Paul and any other people that support his positions, including his recent alternative budget, and we should lobby them to leave the GOP. And we're going to have a party for people that are against big budgets, against the oil lobby, against all lobbyists. They're net liberty people. You know, it's not even just libertarians. It's for people that are for small government and returning the rule of the rule to the common citizen, which is not what the GOP has done. The GOP has been the ultimate traitor to the interests of civil liberties in the United States. Civil liberties meaning the ones as envisioned in the Constitution by our founders. And the Democrats are not, they betrayed it in a different way. They betrayed it by saying that they're gonna reduce the freedoms in order to protect them. Okay, they're gonna empower the tax authorities more. They're going to empower the state more. So they're more direct about it. That doesn't make them traitors to these principles. It just means that they've never believed in them to begin with. The GOP is actually gone and traded in all of their principles for a bunch of oil money, for pharmaceutical money, for the money of other lobbyists. I include all lobbyists, by the way, whether you talk about the NRA, you can talk about AIPAC, you can talk about all those lobbyist groups. We just need senators and congressmen that are willing to fulfill the wish of the people. If they want to support policy A, we should not allow these well-heeled, well-funded toads to come in and just dictate what policies they do. So I'm going to end. This is part one of today. This is only about GOP internal politics and the main message here is this. Senator Paul, any Republicans that are closer to the small government, they're called paleo conservative politics, where you're talking about small government and keeping the rights in the hands of the population as opposed to their rulers. I think you need a new party. And what that does, okay, and we're going to end this video in about a minute. What that means is that you will force the Senate to elect a leader that will be amenable to that side, hopefully. Okay, if you do this, and there's, let's say, five people that, including Paul, that they break away from the GOP, then the vote in the Senate becomes between, in order to elect a Senate Majority Leader, they are going to have to choose somebody besides Mitch McConnell. They'd have to choose somebody that is going to give a certain amount of leeway to this Liberty Caucus, which I think is what it's called, they're going to give some leeway to their agenda, including this alternative budget, which will it will at least do something to control the debt, which the Republicans are not doing. And the Paul, you know, Dr. Ron Paul and his son Rand Paul, they've already published and spoken about their belief that the GOP may never actually pass a balanced budget on its own when it's in power. And they're right. We can't let them get away with it. It's wrong. And that's why you have to reject the GOP, the Republican Party, these frauds, and, you know, vote for yourself and vote. And we're not talking, I don't live in Kentucky, so it's not like Rand Paul gets anything from me. I can't vote for him. And I never got a chance to vote for him in the primary. He dropped out already. So, you know, that we're supporting the people that support us. Okay, if they don't support us, why should we? We don't owe them anything. They're already in office. Senator McConnell is going to be in office, I think, for another 4 years. Okay, and without term limits, which is something else that they're opposing, they'll never be accountable to us. So I think we should start the ball rolling and call for the splitting of the GOP, something I envisioned a while ago. I said, I hope Trump goes in there and reams the GOP a new a-hole. Okay, they have to wreck this party from the inside in order to create something that's useful for anybody. Because the current crop is useful for only one group of people, and those are the lobbyists. And I think that Senator Paul is the best person available right now to change that, and I think that's a mechanism we should act for it. So we'll see you pretty soon. This is Ramon from Bold Like a Leopard, Bold, B-O-L-D, on Facebook, Like a Leopard, strunningleopard.blogspot.com for the blog, and we'll see you around the bend.